The City of London, the centre of the financial world. It's here that some of the finest minds in global finance ply their trade. The pressures are huge, with salaries and bonuses to match.
London's financial services sector encompasses a whole range of commercial activity, from banking and merchant banking to insurance and accountancy. But central to it is the fund management industry. It's fund managers whom the vast majority of us entrust with our long-term investments. They choose which stocks and other assets to invest in on our behalf, and they decide when the time is right to buy and sell. And yes, they are very well remunerated.
In fact, pay has risen sharply in the last few years. One manager, Richard Woolner at M&G Investments, was paid £17.5 million in 2013, 600 times the average UK salary. Research by the FT shows that in the same year, pay per employee in the sector outstripped even investment banking. At one fund management company, the average annual salary was £436,000.
The standard line from the industry is that we need to offer such vast financial rewards to attract the brightest talent. But time and again, research has shown that we overestimate quite how talented fund managers are and how much value they add. For all the talk of star performers, the empirical evidence shows that only a tiny fraction of them are able to outperform the market with any meaningful degree of consistency.
Typical of the reports produced on this subject is this one by the Pensions Institute, based at Cass Business School in London. Researchers examined 516 UK equity funds between 1998 and 2008 and found that just 1% of managers were able to produce sufficient returns to cover their trading and operating costs. But even those managers pocketed for themselves any value they added in fees, leaving nothing for the investor. The remaining 99% of managers failed to deliver any outperformance, either from stock selection or from market timing. In case you're wondering whether those managers were simply unlucky, the researchers found the vast majority weren't. They were genuinely unskilled. While a tiny number of star performers do exist, they are, to quote the report, incredibly hard to identify. Furthermore, it takes 22 years of performance data to be 90% sure that a particular manager's outperformance is genuinely down to skill. For most investors, the report concludes, it is simply not worth paying the vast majority of fund managers to actively manage their assets.
If you're shocked and appalled by those findings, so you should be, the Pensions Institute report is a damning indictment of the fund management industry and is completely at odds with this image we have of the city as a centre of investment expertise. Since this is only the latest in a long line of reports that have said more or less the same thing, it also begs the question, why are so many ordinary investors completely unaware of this scandalous situation?
In fact, there are many reasons. This is a hugely powerful and largely self-regulated industry, which lobbies hard to protect its interests. It also spends a fortune on advertising. And the financial media, which is largely funded by those adverts, has an insatiable demand for stories, which the fund management companies are only too happy to provide. But ultimately, actively managed funds still hold sway over cheaper passive investments such as index funds because investors continue to buy them. We think we're paying for better performance, that greater skill will produce superior results. But investing almost always works the opposite way round. The less you pay, the more you get back. Yes, it's counterintuitive, but it's true.
In the course of this programme, we're going to be looking at just how much investing costs us and at the performance provided by active fund managers. We'll also be exploring more than 100 years of academic research into asset pricing and how markets operate. And we'll be investigating some long-term investment strategies that have been proven to work. Investing was once famously described as the loser's game, and for most people, it still is. we're going to show you how to win it.
We love a bargain. We drive several miles out of our way to save a penny on a litre of petrol. We collect vouchers to save a few pence on grocery items, and we grumble when the government slaps another penny in tax on a pint of beer. And yet, when it comes to our pensions, one of the biggest financial investments we'll ever make, often the biggest, we either don't know what we're paying or don't even seem to care.
One explanation is that when you start a pension, retirement is so far off that you're not particularly concerned about the impact of charges on an investment you might not need for another 40 years or so. But another problem, at least here in the UK, is that charges are complicated and sometimes very difficult to calculate.
The True and Fair campaign, which lobbies for fairer and more transparent charges, accuses the industry of using smoke and mirror tactics.
Fund management industry is supposed to publish something called the ongoing charge. That was under an EU directive that came in 2012. Most companies still only publish the annual management charge. Outside of that annual management charge, there can be a myriad of other charges between 11 and 13 layers. You've got jurisdiction fees, you've got bid offer spread, you've got administration fees, you've got taxes, stamp duty. In a way, it doesn't really matter, though, what all these charges are. It's not up to the individual investor to have to become a detective to find out those charges. It should be the industry doing the work to put that all in an understandable number into a ticket price. When you buy a car, you don't expect to see a list of how much the wheels cost or the engine. Or what you expect to see is how much is the car going to cost you.
What we've seen in recent years is an unbundling of charges. The different fees applied now need to be broken down. That's improved transparency, but it's also added to complexity. Unbundling has also made it look as though charges have gone down, when in fact in many cases they've risen since the regulations came in.
Under the old system, annual charges were usually around 1.5%. But fund managers would pay some of that to third parties, such as fund platforms or financial advisors. Now, although fund management companies typically charge a more modest sounding 1% or 0.75%, they keep all that for themselves. In fact, many funds are pocketing more in charges than ever before. And because there are still separate fees to pay on top of the management charge, investors are often worse off. And of course, all that's before trading costs. Research by Oxford University suggests that many fund managers have responded to regulatory pressure to reduce annual management charges by simply trading more and charging for it in order to maintain their profit margins. The combination of trading costs and the compounding effect of annual charges can take a very large chunk out of the average pension pot, even in America, where overall investment costs are significantly lower than in the UK.
If you're paying big management fees, that the cumulative effect of that, given the way compounding works, is enormous. So active managers basically charge on average 1% in the US in management fees. And you never know what their transactions costs are because that's not a reported number. But they've got to be way higher than they are for passive managers because they're going in and out of securities all the time.
As well as resisting calls to reduce their charges, fund managers have been accused by some of acting almost like a cartel. One survey found that 68% of the UK's largest retail fund sector charged an identical fee.
I think it's a fair point. It is very strange that most of the industry prices at the same point, because what are you pricing for? Expertise. So surely you'd expect someone with superb expertise and great fund management to actually charge more than for someone who's not done so well. But I don't think the industry has got into that competition mode. So a cartel, I wouldn't go as far as a cartel. I don't think that's true. But a cosy club, well, maybe.
Another trend that some have observed is the growing number of funds that claim to be actively managed but are in fact virtually passive. In other words, they broadly track the entire index. Passive funds are cheaper to operate than active and should therefore have lower charges.
Yeah, almost all fund management is a complete rip-off. I mean, we know that. We only have to look at the prices relative to the performance and look at, you know, look, you take a fund and you look at its top 10 or top 20 holdings, and you'll see they're exactly the same as the top 10 or top 20 holdings in a passive fund. So there's a huge, huge market out there full of active funds that are not actually active at all. Or if they are active, this is, you know, this is a very strange definition of active because they're knocking around any old benchmark.
So what sort of impact do charges have on the value of our long-term investments? Well, over 40 years, a pension fund worth almost £250,000 with no charges would be reduced to just £174,500 with an annual charge of 1.5%. If overall charges reach 2.5%, when trading costs are included, that's not uncommon, this reduces the value of the fund to less than £140,000. So even at 1.5%, almost a third of your fund is lost in fees, rising to almost half when charges increase by 1 percentage point.
The True and Fair campaign says fund managers are taking far too much out of people's savings and they could easily afford to lower their charges. It says inefficiencies are rife. And although the industry has grown considerably, there's been little or no attempt to pass on economies of scale to the consumer.
Well, the average UK small to medium-sized business is making between 9 and 15% profit, somewhere around there. The average UK fund management in business is making 30% profit. Those figures speak for themselves. They are growing fat and rich while the consumer is losing out. The very people who are being prudent and saving and investing are not the ones who are retiring with a comfortable pot. It's the fund managers who are becoming millionaires and billionaires because of those profit margins.
Of course, fund management companies could justify high fees and making large profits if they added significant value. Unfortunately, the performance of actively managed funds is consistently very poor.
The aim of fund management is to maximise investment returns. Over time, markets deliver returns on their own. They're what we call the market return. We pay managers to deliver more than the market return. In fact, after costs, they rarely do. One well-known expert famously described it as an industry built on witchcraft.
We have the most prevalent rule that applies to fund managers everywhere, and that is reversion to the mean. A fund that gets way ahead of the market falls way back behind it. It's witchcraft in the sense that, you know, it's managers hovering over a table thinking they have the answer. You know, I've told people, what is the intellectual basis for indexing? The intellectual basis for indexing, as I've said, is gross return minus cost equals net return, period. What is the intellectual basis for active management? I've never heard one. The closest I've come is a manager says, I can do better. They all say I can do better. 100% of them say I can do better than the market. But 100% don't. Probably about 1% of managers can beat the market over the very long term.
That figure of 1%, you may recall, is consistent with the findings of the Pensions Institute report. And that study found that even those 1% of managers actually recover for themselves the value of any outperformance in fees. Several other reports have reached similar conclusions.
This is an independent report commissioned by the UK government into the local government pension scheme, one of the biggest public pension schemes in Europe. As you'd expect, some active managers used by the LGPS have outperformed, but the report found there is no evidence that, in aggregate, the scheme has outperformed regional equity markets. In fact, in many cases, active funds were trounced by passive ones. For example, over 10 years, passive North American equity funds delivered average returns of 2.6% as opposed to 1.7% delivered by active funds. Passive Japanese equity funds also recorded average returns of 2.6% compared to 2.0% for active. Once more, these returns do not take into account the impact of investment charges. The report found that in 2012, asset management costs for the scheme amounted to £790 million, the vast majority of which was paid to active managers. Switching from active to passive investing would save the taxpayer a staggering £660 million a year and deliver similar, if not better, performance. Michael Johnson is a public policy advisor with a specialist interest in pensions. He says the LGPS report is a wake-up call for the whole investment industry.
I think it's a seminal moment in the history of investment management or fund management, because it really lifts the lid on what is essentially an industry that adds no value to anybody. Essentially, very few people enter that industry with the express purpose of enriching others, and they're very good at what they do, which is enriching themselves.
Alan Miller was a successful fund manager, but over the years he became disillusioned with the industry and particularly with the poor performance that managers were delivering year after year.
It used to be the institutions had a big advantage. They would see the companies first, they would see the management. If they were asked sensible questions, they would get information before other people. This does not happen anymore. There's something called the internet, there's something called information given to everyone, and therefore, to have an edge is much harder. It's a bit like companies drilling for oil in the middle of nowhere that nobody's drilled before. It doesn't mean they're not going to discover oil, but the vast majority are probably going to just discover fizzy water. The marketing budgets within the big retail companies are millions and millions of pounds, and they've created this image whereby the customer thinks that these big brands are nice and safe, nice and solid, and they think they're actually getting something better. They're actually getting something worse. This is the irony in that, basically, if you were to sum it up, less is more. The bigger the institution, the bigger the brand, normally the more you pay, and normally the worse the performance.
In a nutshell, you have an industry of fund managers who are trying to outcompete one another in a giant negative sum game. Not a zero sum game, but a negative sum game, because whilst they're doing it, they are extracting charges and fees on an annual basis, which erode the capital of savers. In this competition of trying to outcompete one another, there are bound to be winners and losers every year. And there will be some who claim that on average they add value, i.e. they win more often than they lose. But if one actually examines the data in detail, as I and others have done, it is nigh impossible to work out who is going to outperform the rest on a consistent basis. And therefore, for virtually all investors, making a decision as to which active fund to invest in is a pure lottery.
And that's more or less what the Nobel Prize-winning economist Eugene Farmer has been saying for more than 50 years.
There are lots of studies of persistence in performance. I have one of my students did a very famous thesis on this, Mark Carhart. He ranked the funds based on 5 years of past returns and did that every year, and then examined whether that predicted future performance. Nope, doesn't. So there's very little persistence in performance. But if I take all the funds and look at them over their entire histories, then you're going to see that some of them did extraordinarily well. And books get written about those managers. But in fact, that distribution is pretty consistent with chance.
We asked several of the largest fund management companies to talk to us about performance, but had no success. But the trade body, the Investment Management Association, did agree to give us its point of view. What evidence do you have that active fund management actually works?
Okay, well, over long periods of time, active managers pick stocks that they believe will go up more than the market. But of course, as a group as a whole, we are the market. So that's why you will quite often see reports in the press saying active fund management doesn't outperform the market. Well, the fact is that active kind of is the market, and passive obviously is the market too. So as a group, they can't outperform the market. What people are trying to do is to find managers that do outperform over long periods of time. And in fact, most people are quite successful at doing that, because what you'll find is that the managers that demonstrate an ability to outperform the market reasonably consistently have the bigger funds, and ones that don't contract quite rapidly. So the lion's share of new money and switching money goes into the funds of people who do outperform.
But Michael Johnson is unimpressed.
That's mathematical nonsense. How can you have, if he's suggesting that the majority of money is successful, how can the majority be outperforming the minority? Doesn't make sense. This is an industry that is a genius at obfuscation and bamboozlement with terminology that is utterly meaningless. And it needs to be challenged.
So what are the implications of all this for investors? Well, ultimately, we need active fund managers to set prices to ensure that we all receive fair value for money. But that doesn't mean that every investor should pay for their services. Indeed, the high cost of active management, combined with its dismal track record and the near impossibility of identifying the next star performer, should make the average investor extremely wary. But before we investigate alternative approaches, we're going to find out what the academic evidence says about investing and the best way to go about it.
Investing is often referred to as a game that people play, and the way most of us invest, that's an apt description. As with many games, there's a very large element of luck as well as skill involved, and it's almost impossible to distinguish between the two.
But investing shouldn't be a game. After all, securing your financial future is a serious matter. And although the industry and the pundits like to play it down, there is a wealth of empirical research on this subject that investors can draw on. We're going to touch on some of the key principles of investing established by a long line of academics, including Nobel Prize winners. Investing will always involve a degree of risk, but basing your investment strategy on those key principles will help you sleep more soundly and enjoy life, safe in the knowledge that if you stick with it long enough, you will succeed.
Our story starts in Paris. It was here in 1892 that a young man from Le Havre named Louis Bachelier came to study at university.
Louis Bachelier lost both his parents shortly after leaving school. To support his brother and sister, he briefly took the reins of the family business. But what fascinated him most was mathematics. And at the age of 22, he came here to Paris to study at the Sorbonne. Among the eminent mathematicians whose lectures he attended was the world-renowned Henri Poincaré. It was also in Paris that Bachelier developed an interest in the workings of the financial markets.
After graduating, Bachelier stayed at the Sorbonne to study for a PhD. His specific focus was how stock prices moved. Detailed study of the data led him to conclude that all the available information is already included in the price of a stock. Prices react to new information, which is by nature random, and therefore price movements are also random, or as he rather colourfully put it, no more predictable than the steps of a drunkard. In conclusion, he said, the expectation of the speculator is zero.
The expectation of the speculator is zero because when you buy something, you expect that the price is going to rise, but if you buy something, someone else has to sell it, and this other person thinks the price is going to go down. So if you want to have an exchange at the equilibrium, then the buyer cannot have an advantage over the seller. So the price must be such that future prices is completely unexpected.
In 1900, after 8 years in Paris, Bachelier completed his PhD thesis, La théorie de la spéculation, the theory of speculation. It went largely unnoticed at the time, and it wasn't until very late in his career that Bachelier was finally offered the professorial post he always wanted. But the work is now generally recognised as brilliant, and Bachelier as the father of financial mathematics.
It was the American economist Paul Samuelson who first recognised the significance of Bachelier's thesis in the early 1950s, several years after the Frenchman's death. The theory of speculation had a profound effect on Samuelson's work. For Samuelson, unpredictability was a necessary characteristic of a well-functioning market. In turn, his work greatly influenced the founder of Vanguard, the company that pioneered the use of index funds.
I am not much of an academic. Many of those articles, truth told, I cannot even understand, and very sophisticated. But the great hero of my life was Paul Samuelson. He had won the Nobel Prize in economics, one of the first American to do so, back in the, I guess, early 1970s. And providentially, the first issue of Journal of Portfolio Management came out in the spring of 1974. And there was an article by Paul Samuelson called Challenge to Judgment. And he basically said, show me the brute evidence that managers can outperform. If you can't show me that brute evidence, you should own a passive market index like the S&P 500, operated at very low cost and no sales loads. And that was the inspiration that basically inspired, got me going on the idea.
There's one institution more than any other that's contributed to our understanding of asset pricing and how markets work. Over the years, the University of Chicago has produced an almost embarrassing array of Nobel Prize winners who've researched and written about this subject. I've come to interview its latest Nobel laureate.
It was the advent of computers in the 1950s which enabled researchers like Eugene Farmer to take financial mathematics to the next level.
I always say the work on markets and the efficient markets theory and empirical work that came out of that basically was motivated by the computer and the freedom that gave people to do empirical work.
It was for his work on the efficient market hypothesis, for which Professor Farmer was recognized by the Nobel Prize Committee. The EMH reinforces the view of Bachelier and Samuelson that all relevant information is already incorporated in the price of a particular stock. If you take the EMH to its logical conclusion, it's impossible, or at least very difficult, either to purchase undervalued shares or sell stocks for inflated prices. It's also impossible, or all but impossible, to outperform the market, either through expert stock selection or through market timing. To what extent do you think the efficient market hypothesis has stood the test of time?
It's a model. The word model implies that it's not perfect. Clearly, insiders have information that's not in the market prices, and there's pretty clear evidence that they gain from their trades. Once you get past that group, very difficult to find people who do have information that's not in the price. So that the proposition that markets are efficient has stood up very well.
What do you say to those who argue that what happened between 2000 and 2003 and again between 2007 and 2009 when markets fell 50% or even more, those who say that that disproves the efficient market hypothesis?
I put this in my Nobel lecture. I put a little plot and I put in recessions on the plot. And what you see is that there are big price declines anticipating recessions pretty consistently. The bigger the recession, the bigger the price decline. So in 2007-08, we had a huge recession, and there was a 50%+ drop in the prices of stocks. That happens consistently. Expect it to happen. Bad times, prices are going to go down.
As Eugene Farmer says, the EMH is a hypothesis. It's not meant to be perfect. And even though assets are fairly valued today, they could still fall or rise sharply in price tomorrow once new information is known. However, it is generally accepted now by academics who've researched this subject in detail that markets are fundamentally efficient. Yes, there are those who disagree with Professor Farmer's interpretation of the facts, but the evidence itself is indisputable.
The core of Gene's research is really facts. When you think about Gene Farmer and efficient markets, don't think about Einstein and some big theory that nobody can understand. Gene's theoretical framework is quite easy to understand. Competition means that prices reflect information. what Gene did is like what Darwin did. Darwin had a simple theory, evolution by natural selection. We can all understand that. But he went out and put all the finch beaks together and wrote the big book and saw how every different kind of animal fed into that. Well, that's what Gene did.
It's often said by supposed experts that the theories of Bichelier, Samuelson and Farmer are outdated, that they don't do justice to the complexity of today's markets. True, their findings have been known for a long time, but they still haven't been disproved, and if anything, they're more relevant now than they've ever been.
Again, it's all to do with competition, with the principle of equilibrium on which Bichelier based his theory of speculation. Simply put, there are two sides to every trade. For everyone buying a particular stock, thinking they're getting a good deal, there's a seller equally convinced that they are. Now think of the size of the global equity markets today, with millions of investors trading typically around $60 trillion US dollars every year. Think of the increasingly high frequency of trading. A decade ago, there was an average of around 20,000 trades every second, but that figure has increased nearly 100-fold to 1.8 million trades a second. Also, think of the growing number of professional stock pickers out there. In the US, for example, there are 14 times more mutual funds today than there were in 1979. All these market participants are competing with one another, and each time they trade, they're giving their estimate of how much a stock is worth. So, we should see the price of a stock as the very latest, best estimate of the entire market. That's how efficient markets have become. Of course, investors don't just buy one stock, one mutual fund, or one asset class, or at least they'd be taking a considerable risk if they did. It was another Nobel Prize winner, Professor Harry Markowitz, who first emphasized the importance of studying the risks and returns of an entire portfolio.
Really, the cornerstone of all what we call modern portfolio theory rests on this idea of diversification. And until Markowitz gave what was almost an engineering analysis of how stock price movements interacted with each other, nobody had ever really considered it. Even though prices don't move in nice sort of, let's say, sine wave fashion, prices do go up and down through time. So a stock price will go up, it'll go down, sometimes many times over the course of a day, but certainly over longer periods of time. And basically what he discovered was, that's true and every stock does that, but they don't do it at the same time. And it's almost like if you think of two sine waves that are in opposite phase with each other, they will ultimately cancel each other out. And even though it was not the case that these stocks were in opposite phase, but as long as they weren't in exactly the same phase with each other, you still got some dampening effect.
Then in the 1960s came another important breakthrough when Professor William Sharpe developed what he called the capital asset pricing model. The CAPM, as it's often referred to, is a model for determining the price of a capital asset, such as a stock or a bond, in an efficient market. The price, Sharpe deduced, depends on two things. First, the risk of holding that security when markets fall, and secondly, the expected return. Ideally, he concluded, an investor should hold all the available securities in a particular market. And just in case there are any doubts about his academic credibility, Sharpe also won the Nobel Prize.
In the CAPM, Sharpe also introduced the concept of market beta, the measure of the volatility of a security or portfolio in comparison to the market as a whole. Sharpe referred simply to market risk, but in the decades that followed, fellow academics identified specific types of risk, or beta, often referred to as factors. This gave rise, in the 1990s, to the Farmer-French three-factor model.
What we mean by factors are things that drive common variation across stocks. So if I'm trying to say, well, airline stocks tend to move together, you could imagine an airline stock factor because it's going to pick up common variation. Or if you say, well, some stocks tend to move a lot when the market goes up, some stocks don't move so much when the market goes up. We could have a market factor in there that just picks up the difference in the way the stocks move relative to the market. We happen to know small stocks tend to move together and big stocks tend to move together. Put together a size factor, something the way we defined it, had lots of small stocks and was short lots of big stocks, that would pick up that variation between how small stocks behave and how big stocks behave. So there was the overall sensitivity to the stock market. We also knew small stocks had a higher premium than big stocks, and small stocks tended to move together relative to big stocks. And then we also knew value stocks, companies whose ratio of book to market, or earnings to price, or cash flow to price, something where it was a fundamental of the company divided by the price. Those value stocks tend to have a higher average return than growth stocks.
To the original three factors, market risk, size, and value, French and Farmer have since added two more, profitability and investment. So companies with higher future earnings will have higher stock market returns. And perhaps surprisingly, firms that increase capital investment tend to produce poorer subsequent performance than those that don't.
Actually, those two factors, profitability and investment, explain the value factor. So you can actually drop the value factor if you want to and use a four-factor model. Will there be factors in the future? Possibly. A model stands until it doesn't stand anymore, until a better one comes along.
Now, some of that might sound a little complicated, but these are the basic building blocks of what is often referred to as the science of the capital markets. These are very important principles with implications for every investor. So before we apply these principles, let's recap.
Markets are competitive and there are two sides to every trade. The price of a security is the very latest, best guess estimation of its value by the entire market. Because it incorporates and reflects all the available information, markets are therefore very efficient. Asset prices respond to new information, which is by nature random. Price movements are therefore random as well. And because the prices of different assets go up and down at different times, it pays to be diversified. The optimum portfolio is one that holds every security available. The return you can expect from a particular security is related to the risk of holding it when markets fall, and that risk is known as beta. But there are different types of risk you can expose yourself to. Small company stocks and value stocks, for example, are generally more volatile than larger company and so-called growth stocks. But if you hold on to them for long enough, they should deliver a higher return. So how can ordinary investors apply that academic research, the lessons learnt from more than 100 years of rigorous research? How can they apply that to achieving their financial goals? Well, this might sound dramatic, but the work of Louis Bichelier and of Nobel Prize winners like Samuelson, Sharp and Farmer should make us question everything we thought we knew about investing and almost everything the industry and the media is telling us we should be doing. Most of all, the evidence should make us extremely wary of anyone who claims that they have the knowledge to beat the market. Because markets are fundamentally efficient, consistent outperformance is almost impossible. So instead of paying large sums in fees to active fund managers to deliver average returns, we should invest instead in passive funds that simply track an index at a much lower cost. Ultimately, though, it's not about theories or intellectual arguments at all. It all boils down to simple mathematics.
If you think about a marketplace and you think about a strategy in which an investor buys a proportionate share of all the securities, so if you have 1% of the money in the market, you buy 1% of each of the stocks, you buy 1% of each of the amounts of each of the bonds outstanding. So you have this truly representative market portfolio. If you think about that strategy, and then you think about all the people engaging in other strategies, active strategies, holding disproportionate amounts of this or that, then you ask at the end of any period, be it a year, a month, you name it, what did the passive investors, the index fund folks, earn before costs? And let's say that's 12%, just to take a number. And then you ask, what did the average euro or whatever currency it may be invested by all the active managers earn before costs? It has to be the same number. If the total made 12% and a subset made 12%, or the other bunch, the average euro in that sector had to make the same amount before costs. After costs, it's a different story. A well-designed index fund should have a very low cost of management. It should have very low turnover, very low transactions costs. Actively managed funds, by their very nature, have higher management fees. They employ more skilled people. They also have transactions costs because they're active. So net of costs, the average euro in the passive sector must outperform the average euro in the active sector. And that's just arithmetic.
Despite the mathematical superiority of passive investing and the welter of empirical evidence supporting it, the industry has always tried to discredit it. When Vanguard introduced its first index fund in 1976, the idea was slated.
And Mr. Johnson, the head of Fidelity, said, "I can't imagine our shareholders would ever settle for average results. They expect to be superior." Famous poster came out in Wall Street. Stamp out index funds. They're un-American. And there was Uncle Sam with a cancel stamp. Bam, 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 bam. Canceling all the stock certificates. Among the many kind of claims, you can imagine all this. You wouldn't settle for an average brain surgeon if you needed brain surgery. So why would you settle for an average manager? As if there's any relevance to those two very different things.
It was Bogle who had the last laugh. Vanguard now has more assets under management than any other company in the world, including Fidelity, which, incidentally, is now the second biggest provider of index funds. And yet, even in the United States, where passive has a bigger market share than in the UK, active remains by far the most popular way to invest.
I laugh because, you know, I've been telling the same story for 52 years now. We've gone from zero passive investing up to about 20 or 30% in the U.S. market, so it's very slow. Penetration is very slow. So what I like to remind people, though, is that active management is a zero-sum game before costs.
The whole cost argument from an investment perspective is actually counterintuitive. You know, if you think about your life in other areas, so if you're out buying a car and, you know, you can buy a Rolls Royce and pay, you know, whatever Rolls Royces are going for today, or you can buy an inexpensive Hyundai, you're going to feel a difference in the car. Now, whether it's worth that, you know, that huge price differential to you, only you as a buyer can make that decision. But you're definitely going to feel there's a difference in quality in terms of durability and so forth. In investing, that equation does not hold. And so when you think about the average investor who's also a consumer, and you know, they're used to the more I pay, the higher the quality, typically the better the results I get, you come to investing and it's just the opposite. And you know, I think that's a really hard behavior for people to unlearn.
Perhaps surprisingly, another long-standing advocate of passive investing is the most famous active investor of all. Warren Buffett once said, "When the dumb investor realizes how dumb he is and buys an index fund, he becomes smarter than the smartest investors." More recently, Buffett gave this instruction to the trustee of his estate. Put 10% of the cash in short-term government bonds and 90% in a very low-cost index fund. The long-term results from this policy will be superior to those attained by most investors, whether pension funds, institutions, or individuals who employ high-fee managers.
Warren Buffett is sort of a contradiction here, and so people take what they want to hear from Buffett. And the contradiction is this. Clearly, Buffett believes the efficient market hypothesis isn't correct, and he himself has said, if it was true, I wouldn't be here, and people like me and Charlie Munger would not get the great results. On the other hand, Buffett has told people in advice in his 1996 shareholder letter, if you invest in an index fund, you're virtually guaranteed to outperform the vast majority of investors, both institutional and individual. Virtually guaranteed. Now, it's only virtually guaranteed because he doesn't know if you're going to be able to stay the course. If he knew you'd stay the course, which is the second part of it, he would say it is guaranteed. It's simple math. Passive investors must outperform active investors in aggregate because they have less costs. If you look in the mirror and see Warren Buffett or maybe Charlie Munger or Peter Lynch, go ahead and invest and try to pick stocks and beat the market. The rest of the world looking in the mirror doesn't see such a sight, and then I would suggest you should follow Buffett's advice and you should invest in index funds or other passively managed funds.
In recent years, even the great Warren Buffett has failed to beat index funds after costs. It's little wonder then that increasingly fund managers themselves are starting to acknowledge that this really is a loser's game.
I think I realized it years ago when I was a full-time active investment manager. And there were times when we could beat the index, we made the right calls, and that was very satisfying, but it was extremely difficult to sustain it year after year. And the more research I did into it, the more I realized there were very few people who were able to sustain our performance sufficiently to cover all the extra costs of active investing. So I gradually came to the view that a fund should have rather more in index tracking than was then common. In those days, I think I favoured some sort of mixture. More recently, the more I've looked at the build-up of numbers, the more I think it is very difficult to find those star managers who are going to win. And there's always the danger that they had a very good strategy that works for 2, 3, 5 years. You then buy in because you were persuaded, and that may be just the point where that strategy starts to go wrong through no particular fault of their own. Fashions come and go, and quite a lot of so-called stellar management performance is just being on the right particular theme at a time when that's popular in the market.
So the fund management industry won't tell you this. It has far too much to lose by doing so. But the most appropriate investment vehicle for the vast majority of investors is the humble index fund. No, it's not perfect. We'll explain why later. And although it's a relatively simple way to invest, requiring very little maintenance, there are still some very important decisions for index fund investors to make.
There is really no such thing as passive investing, because you have to choose where the money's going to go. Somebody has to choose if the money's going to be in Japan or South America or, you know, emerging market bonds or Russia or whatever it is. Those decisions have to be made. Those are active decisions. Then, once you've made those decisions, you're choosing the ETF or you're choosing the tracker, whatever it is. And in doing that, you're choosing a strategy.
But there is another, much bigger issue that needs to be addressed. As we've heard, passive investing is still far less popular than active. But what if that changed? What if passive continues to grow? And eventually, most people decided to invest passively.
Here is how the perfect world of the Chicago efficient markets theory of finance works. We all get religion, and we all just index. And then one guy thinks, oh, you know what? The new iPhone is great. I'd like to buy Apple. Apple's only, say, $500 a share. It's worth $1,000. I'm going to buy some Apple. So he says, hey guys, I'll buy your Apple. I'll offer you $600 a share. And we say, we're just indexers. We're not going to alter our market weights. You must know something we don't know. So we're going to hold Apple in its market weights. But thanks. Okay, so God. How about 700? We're just indexers. And then finally, he bids the price up to the $1,000 a share. The ideal world, this isn't the real world. The ideal world, if we all indexed, we would never lose to the active managers because we would never sell. And they would just bid the prices up so prices reflect information. you can see the hole in the story. The active manager should go drive a cab. He's not earning any money. Our world is one in which active managers do trade, and they trade and make money, and they bring the information in. The big puzzle is, who trades against them? Why don't we defend those of us who don't know anything? Why don't we defend ourselves just by indexing?
So we've explained how the academic evidence points overwhelmingly to indexing being the best way for the vast majority of people to invest. Index funds should form the biggest part of every portfolio. We've already mentioned the importance of asset allocation, deciding how much to invest in equities or bonds, for example. Another key decision is what type or types of index fund to go for. The traditional and still the most common type is the cap-weighted or market value-weighted fund. One drawback with cap-weighted funds is that as the price of a stock goes up, so does its weighting. That can sometimes leave you overweighted in a relatively small number of stocks.
Go back to 1999, 2000, the technology bubble. You know, you suddenly had 6, 7, or 8% of a portfolio in Cisco, and the next thing it's bombed out. So the question then is there a better way of constructing a portfolio, a better way of constructing, if you like, an index? And some experiments in the past, and have been going on for 10 years, have suggested there are better ways. I'll give you a really simple example. Instead of weighting by the market capitalization of each stock, how about weighting by, well, make it equal weighted. So you've got 100 stocks in the FTSE, put 1% in each. So that's the sort of thing that starts us researching, looking at the top 1,000 US stocks and asking our simple rules like that. We call them heuristics. Are they capable of forming portfolios and actually do better over time than, say, buying the S&P 500 or the FTSE 100?
You'll remember we looked at different types of risk, or beta, often known as factors. Certain types of stocks are more volatile, but do offer higher returns in the long run. It's now possible to buy an index fund comprised entirely of small company or value stocks, for example, to complement conventional index funds. They're more expensive than cap-weighted funds, but still far cheaper than actively managed funds. This sort of strategy is usually referred to as smart beta, though others call it alternative beta, fundamental indexing, factor investing, or tilting. Whatever name you prefer to call it, it's becoming increasingly popular.
The overall cap weight market portfolio, including everything, not just stocks, is always a legitimate portfolio in any asset pricing model. It's always one of the so-called efficient portfolios. But if you take, for example, our work seriously, what it says is there are multiple dimensions of risk, and you can tilt towards these dimensions, so you can move away from the market portfolio towards these dimensions, depending on your taste for bearing different sources of risk. There isn't one strategy that's optimal or efficient in this sense. There's a whole spectrum.
A staunch proponent of this approach is Yves Schufferty, who runs Tobam, an asset management company based in Paris. For him, it's all about diversification. Ideally, the investor should be exposed to all the different risk factors.
In order to build a diversified portfolio, you will want to try your best to have your own risk evenly contributed by all the risk factors that are available in the universe. If every single source of risk, if every single risk factor evenly contribute to my own risk, by definition, you will not be able to tell me that I am biased. And if you cannot say that I am biased, probably I will be able to say that I am diversified.
Others are more skeptical about smart beta, or at least that particular label.
I think the name is unfortunate in that it seems to suggest that it's a smart outcome, when in fact, smart is a requirement when it comes to smart beta, as it's called. It's a factor bet, it's a rules-based factor bet where somebody is choosing to index a part of the market or part of a broader market cap index. Now, that in itself can be fine, but I think it's important to understand that you're taking a very active decision at the start there to actively go after one factor of the market.
I think it makes it more complicated for an investor, because previously you had active and passive. It's taken us a long time to get across what passive is, and I still don't think many people understand what it is. Yeah, we believe that smart beta is another way of getting an extra 1% or 2% return per year. But to the average person on the street, I think it does confuse them and just means that there's more product for them to actually try to understand.
I think smart beta is another industry label that has emerged out of the funds management community, possibly out of some marketing departments, cynically. The best question an investor can ask is where do returns come from? And really no one has studied this more deeply than the academic community. And so when it comes to investment capital, it makes so much sense to do with that capital only that which has been proven. And that's where dimensions of return become so powerful, because they've survived peer review, they've survived intense scrutiny.
Complicated or not, is smart beta an option worth exploring? Well, it might be, depending on the level of risk you're willing to take.
One touchstone to remember: the average investor has to hold the market portfolio. If you decide you're going to buy value, somebody else has to hold less value. If you're going to buy Microsoft, somebody else has to hold less Microsoft. The average portfolio has to add up to the market. And anybody who outperforms the market, somebody else has to underperform the market. We need a better theory of why we should do anything but just hold the market index. I do think there is one. And that is, if you view these as alternative dimensions of risk, and that what we're doing in asset markets is basically writing insurance to each other. Look at the stocks. Are you really the kind of investor who can bear that kind of risk? And what you are doing is you're writing insurance to other investors who don't want to bear that kind of risk. What is the risk? Why are some people not willing to bear that risk? Why can't I bear that risk? Is a good place to start thinking about what are these alternative betas you want to invest in.
Before moving on, let's briefly summarize. Mathematically, after costs, the average returns of a passive investor have to exceed the average returns of an active investor. The market cap-weighted index reflects the consensus view of the market and therefore is the ideal starting point for a passive investor. But the cap-weighted index isn't perfect, and depending on how much risk they're prepared to take, investors may want to tilt their portfolios towards other types of risk or beta, such as small company or value stocks.
Beta, as we've said, is a measure of overall market risk. But what about alpha? That's the name we give to any return delivered by a fund or an individual security over and above the benchmark index. First and foremost, you should be indexing. Alternatively, you could tilt your portfolio towards different types of risk. But is there ever a case for chasing alpha, either by picking the stocks yourself or by using an active fund manager?
That's a great question. What I know is the average investor who does invest in an active fund has to expect to lose relative to a passive strategy. Why do I say that? What I know is if one active investor chooses to overweight some stock, then at least one other active investor has to underweight that stock. One might win by overweighting. If he wins, he loses by underweighting. So it's a zero-sum game before we start thinking about costs. And what I expect, what we see over and over again, is that active trading costs money, and active managers charge a lot for their services. Now notice, one of them might have been brilliant, but the extent that one of them is brilliant, the person on the other side must be whatever the negative of brilliant is here, minus brilliant.
I take a dim view of active management. For any investor to invest, you have to understand why the person you're giving your money to is in the half that's going to make money, not the half that's going to lose money. What's special about him? What's special about you that you know how to evaluate him? Somebody has to have some skill. There's evidence on how much skill is there out there. How many good managers are there? How many bad managers are there? And it's really depressing. If you don't know what you're doing, don't step into the casino.
So let's be clear about this. All the evidence is stacked against active fund management. But say, for example, in spite of everything our experts have said, you still want to take a gamble with part of your portfolio. How do you choose an active fund from the thousands of funds available?
Well, certainly not just by looking at past performance. A consumer would need to do a number of things. Firstly, they can just offset the decision making altogether and go to an independent financial advisor, and many do, and they will select funds for them. And that may be a mix of active and passive funds, and that's a perfectly sensible thing to do. But they may also, if they wish to make decisions for themselves, they may wish to look not only at managers' track record, but to actually read about what they say about themselves, their style of choosing stocks, and to read what people say in the media about them and what other analysts are saying. So I think there will be a number of factors in making a decision, and it certainly shouldn't just be past performance on its own.
What they want to look for are generally broadly diversified portfolios. They want to look at the portfolio manager and the company behind that manager and make sure that they're long tenured, that they've had a consistent process and a consistent philosophy. You don't want people who change their stripes every couple of years or every market cycle. The other thing you want to look at is what price you're paying. Morningstar did some really groundbreaking work a couple years ago where they found the best predictor of future performance is actually cost. So if you get the right manager with a long-term philosophy and a consistent philosophy and you have a low-priced portfolio, your chances of actually performing as well or better than the index go up.
An example of a fund management company that does take a long-term view and which keeps costs down by trading less is Edinburgh-based Saracen Fund Managers.
I think in the old days, everyone tried to take a long-term approach, but it feels with the advent of hedge funds, quarterly numbers, a lot of the fund management industry has been getting caught up in the short-term noise and volatility caused by quarterly results and news flow. We try and strip that out and actually take a long-term view. What we do here is we forecast out 5 years, which is much longer term than the market does, to try and take advantage of, identify opportunities.
Statistically, small funds like those run by Saracen tend to perform better than very large ones, and their managers are more likely to invest their own money in them, which is always a good sign.
Many of the large firms, the managers aren't aligned with their investors, because they're paid by bonuses from performance, not for how well the fund does directly. You know, and one thing that that Warren Buffett certainly has is a huge amount of his own personal savings involved with his fund. And an investor should be always consider, is the fund manager aligned with them as much as they should be?
Also, remember the benefit of having exposure to different factors of risk. Value investing is particularly worth investigating, as are the writings of the man usually credited with founding it, the British-born American academic and professional investor, Benjamin Graham. For an insight into Graham's investment philosophy, we visited the university where he studied and taught, Columbia in New York City.
You're looking for cheap, ugly, disappointing, obscure, and otherwise orphaned stocks. Portfolios formed on those bases significantly outperform portfolios of glamour stocks. And I think there are three fundamental human characteristics that account for the persistent outperformance of those portfolios. The first is that people will systematically overpay for the dream of getting rich quick. And that's why these glamour stocks get overvalued. And remember, the average return has to be the average return on all stocks. People who specialize in the glamour stocks are going to underperform the market, and so staying away from them will benefit you. Second thing is people don't like to look closely at ugly. The behavioral finance name for this is loss aversion. And you look at these portfolios of cheap stocks, two-thirds of them may go bankrupt. But the ones that don't do so well that the portfolios of these stocks substantially outperform the market. The third thing that I think cements the first two effects are human beings are not good at dealing with uncertainty. And therefore, when they think about situations, they try and assume the uncertainty away and are overconfident.
Like Bachelier, Samuelson, Sharp and Farmer, Graham's aim was to take the guesswork out of picking stocks. He famously inspired one of his pupils, Warren Buffett. And Buffett's subsequent success is testimony to the validity of Graham's approach.
Warren Buffett has described Benjamin Graham's book, The Intelligent Investor, as by far the best book about investing ever written. In it, Graham wrote that investment is most intelligent when it is most businesslike. In his preface to the fourth edition of the book, Buffett said, "The sillier the market's behavior, the greater the opportunity for the businesslike investor. Follow Graham and you'll profit from folly rather than participate in it." And that brings us to another important aspect of successful investing. Whichever route you choose to go down, whether it's passive, active, or somewhere in between, your behavior is absolutely critical, especially at times that emotions are running high.
One of the big difficulties is getting people to stay the course when results are disappointing. It should come as no surprise to people that markets go up and they go down. When they go down, there's a tendency to people go, gosh, are we on the edge of an abyss? You know, will things really get bad from here? And they, like in 2008, 2009, it was difficult to get people to stay the course. My heart goes out to these people that were invested in equities, lost half their money, then got out and missed the rebound. It may take quite a while for them ever to get back even again.
Everyone knows the idea is to buy low and sell high, but time and again, we do the precise opposite. This chart shows how much money US investors have put into and taken out of equity funds since the late 1990s. The graph peaks in January 2000. In other words, investors were piling in just as the market reached the top. Then, even worse, they bailed out just as prices reached the bottom and were about to rise again. That kind of behavior is sadly all too typical, and even the professionals are prone to it. The effect on the long-term value of our investments can be catastrophic.
So how do we, as investors, curb that sort of self-destructive behavior? Well, one way is to have an automated approach to investing. So you choose your strategy and the level of risk you're prepared to take, and then you leave your investments exactly as they are. Either once or at the most twice a year, you rebalance your portfolio to realign it with your tolerance of risk. But again, that can be done automatically.
There are lots of styles that work over the long term. That, you know, value works, dividend investing works, momentum investing works if you get it right. All sorts of things work, but they only work if you stick with them. And one of the problems that active fund managers have is it's very, very difficult for them to stick with any kind of style because they get buffeted around by opinion, by different methods of valuation, by markets, by what people say to them in the pub, by what their colleagues are doing, etc. It's very hard for them to stick to a strategy. You know, when I see fund managers, and I see a lot of fund managers, they pretty much all tell me the same thing. They have a strategy, they outline their strategy. It's very often quality or value or income based. They have back tested it, they show me their back testing, it looks great, they go away, and you think, well, if they do that, that'll work out very well. But they never do it. Or if they do it, they do it for 6 months or 8 months, and then they're distracted by something, the strategy changes, and their performance suffers as a result. But what fundamental indices do, or indices that are based on any one particular factor, is they force consistency. You have to choose a style, and then the computer makes you stick to that style, and that's when it works.
It also helps to have a financial advisor to keep you on track. But not just any advisor. Far too many advisors believe, wrongly, that their primary role is to pick the right funds and to persuade their clients to switch to a different fund when, inevitably, their original recommendation underperforms.
There are two great roles for an advisor. One is to help individuals understand themselves and what their real financial purposes are and what their anxieties would be in anticipation, so they can lay out a really sensible long-term investment program. That's one. And the second is to hold hands and encourage staying the long, long, long term, because the long term can be very, very positive if we only have the ability to stay with it through the thick and the thin, through the exciting positives, through the terrifying negatives that cause most of us to make mistakes.
Why in the name of peace do we pay any attention to the stock market? The stock market is a derivative. The stock market is the derivative of what? It is the derivative of the earning power and dividend yields on, in the case of this nation, of U.S. corporations. The dividend yield plus the earnings growth that follows is what creates the fundamental return on stocks. And the speculative return on stocks, compared to that investment return, is how much people are willing to pay for a dollar of earnings. And that carries the market up and down. And in the long run, in the last 100 years, the contribution of speculative return to total market return is zero. And the contribution of investment return happened to have 4.5% dividend yield, 4.5% earnings growth. That's the 9% you read about at the past the U.S. market. The stock market is a giant distraction to the business of investing.
Of course, it doesn't help that we're constantly hearing about the markets. There are specialist magazines. Almost every major newspaper has a money section. There are radio shows and, of course, entire television channels devoted to the latest on the markets and where the so-called experts think they're heading.
When it comes to investor returns, the media is definitely a bad influence on the retail investor. What the media does is encourage activity. It encourages people to buy and sell. Invariably, it's not just the unnecessary costs involved in a lot of buying and selling. It leads to people making bad timing decisions. For their own benefit, I think investors should block out as much noise as possible.
And that, in a nutshell, is the secret to winning the loser's game. First, choose a strategy that's based on evidence, preferably one designed to capture the returns of the whole market, and then tailor it to your attitude to risk. Secondly, stick to your chosen strategy through thick and thin. Yes, rebalance your portfolio, but most important of all, stay the course. Our journey is almost done. We've explained how the odds are heavily stacked against the ordinary investor, and how by settling for an average return and refusing to pay a small fortune in charges, you can end up as one of the winners, saving yourself a great deal of time, effort, and worry in the process. But there is a much bigger issue here. It's not just we as individuals who are losing out. The whole world faces a pensions crisis. We're living longer, and although most of us will also work longer, there'll be huge numbers of people retiring without enough funds to sustain them throughout their later lives. In deciding to dispense with active management for its local government pension scheme, the UK has joined a list of governments, including Australia, Norway, and California, which have started to question the traditional way of doing things.
Governments are realising that to the extent that pensioners have small pensions, they ultimately fall back on the state for assistance. So there is a very strong economic rationale to have pension funds perform better.
The investing sector has become a key component of the global economy. Here in Scotland, for example, hundreds of fund managers, brokers, advisory firms and consultants have concentrated around Edinburgh, now Europe's fourth largest financial centre. Yes, the sector does make a significant contribution to economic wealth and tax revenues. But as we've seen, it also takes a great deal from ordinary investors through the charges it levies. So has the investment industry simply grown too big for our own good?
The fund management industry, it needs huge reform. Of course it does. There are way too many funds. There's way too much attempt to produce difference out of nothing. And you know, this is a huge problem in the financial industry. If you want to sell things, you need to differentiate yourself from the next guy along. But in fact, investing is remarkably simple. I mean, you know, not necessarily easy, but simple, straightforward. It doesn't need so many different products. It doesn't need so much differentiation. It doesn't need quite so many people. And it doesn't need to be so expensive.
I think the real problem is there's far too much expectations in this whole area. You know, this will be disappointing news for people in finance in a way, but really we've got too many people employed in it, doing too much, trading too much, for very small amounts of gain
for the population as a whole, but of course a very large transfer of finance into the hands of the people doing it.
The industry says it accepts that passive approaches to investing are likely to become more popular. But not surprisingly, it doesn't like the idea of the active fund sector contracting.
I don't fear for the future because I think active will maintain a very strong role in investment management as a whole. But I think that it would be detrimental to the operation of the market, to investment in capital investment in corporate UK, if active were to become too marginalised. And I don't believe that that will happen.
It's true that the market system needs active managers to function. But the academic consensus is that a global fund industry just 20% the size it currently is would be more than sufficient to maintain market efficiency. Many of our experts also believe that the huge financial rewards on offer to fund managers are counterproductive in that they incentivize very short-term outperformance when most people are, or at least should be, investing for the much longer term. In 2013, the average Wall Street bonus rose by 15%, bringing the overall industry total to a staggering $26.7 billion. Remember, that's not salaries, that's just bonuses.
The bonus system is absolutely ridiculous. The very idea that we should be paying people extra if they perform well, I always find absolutely infuriating on the basis that, you know, we are already paying them for them to do their best. If they do their best, why should we have to pay them more?
If there were fewer fund managers earning more modest pay packages, perhaps more of our brightest graduates would shun the city and pursue careers instead in sectors where they really can make a difference. As John Bogle likes to say, it's not the speculators or the markets that add value. Ultimately, it's successful businesses that drive investment returns. And despite the lazy way in which business and the markets are often lumped together by journalists and politicians, those are in fact two very different things.
The function of the securities markets is to allow new capital to be directed to their highest and best use. That's true, but think about the math for a minute. We probably get, in the last couple of years, maybe $300 billion a year that goes to new offerings and additional IPOs and additional offerings. We trade 56, most recent number, 56 trillion. And that means something like 99.5% of what the stock market does, of what we do as investors, is trade with one another. And a half of 1% is directing capital to new business. There is a system that has failed society, period.
So there's wide agreement that the investment industry needs to change. But where will change come from?
I believe the industry realizes a lot more than it's ever willing to fess up. Underneath the surface, the individuals in the city in general realize that they've had it too good for too long. Now, will change come from within? Pretty unlikely. The trade bodies, of which the IMA is one, are masters at doing just enough to keep the show on the road in terms of hinting at change and improvement for the consumer is around the corner.
The IMA, the Investment Management Association, is a trade body that is there for its members. It is financed and supported by the members, which is the fund management industry and the banking industry. Is it doing a better job of protecting the investor and making things more transparent for an investor? Definitely not.
Michael Johnson sees a key role for journalists and educators in bringing about change for the better.
There's a strong campaign, for example, to increase education in schools, financial literacy. Maybe that's a starting point, and the media could usefully attune itself to the level of technical understanding of the man in the street as in an explaining role as well as in an inquisitive role, rather than simply reporting the stories that it's given by highly paid PR agents acting on behalf of very wealthy clients.
Ultimately, though, it's up to us, ordinary investors, to demand a better deal. Yes, we do need to put more into our pensions and other long-term investments. But we also have to start questioning why the industry is taking so much out, to start insisting on a fairer share of investment returns, especially as those returns in future are likely to be smaller than they have been in the past. We need to wise up, to be more realistic. We have to be less gullible, and yes, perhaps a little less greedy as well. There are no magic shortcuts to successful investing, but over the last 120 years or so, we've learned so much about how it works that it's simply not necessary anymore to pay expensive experts to gamble with our money. Together, we will win this game in the end.
There's this great quote from Adam Smith in The Wealth of Nations that says there's one principle that is so simple and so universal we don't even need to defend it, and that is the ultimate object of all business should be to serve the consumer.